Welcome everybody to your Nexon sponsor Lee coverage, coming to you live from our Berlin studio. I am TobiWan, bringing you game number one of this best of three semi-final, which is currently going on right now. We're going to jump ourselves into our game, into our draft screen, and in fact, let me just hit this little button across. I also want to say hello to everyone out there on the live stream. I know it's been actually a long time since we used this live stream, for example. But we have been streaming out non-stop. I was streaming till 1 a.m. in the morning, and now it's a wonderful 11 o'clock in the morning over here in Berlin. Either way, though, I am looking forward to seeing our game up right now. This is possibly going to be... Whoop, that's not the button I want to hit. This is going to be possibly one of the closest games that we will ever have coming out of the Nexon Sponsorship League. I kind of almost wish that both these teams would have met themselves in the grand final, which can still happen. It's a double elimination bracket that happens here for the Nexon Sponsorship League, so it's not over until the Fat Lady most definitely starts chiming in. But right now, we do have FXO as well as MVP. Both teams able to triumph in their semi-final matches, and when they did play, they played up... FXO played up against Kids, and MVP went up against Virtual Throne. They took their games out 2-0 when they matched up there. And in fact, there's only one team which ended up getting pushed to 3, and that was EOT, who ended up pushing StarTail to a third game. And StarTail ended up coming out on top. So there's still more rounds to be played out. Of course, for the round of 8, there was no second lifeline. There's just the lower bracket semi-final. So the two loser teams from this matchup will drop down to the lower bracket. So at least now you've got yourself to a point that there is a lifeline available for you. But at the same time, you don't want to be using that. You don't want to be dropping down to the lower bracket here. And these guys, well, actually, the MVP boys are actually quite hilarious. A lot of these guys do speak English, especially Kaiser. Kaiser was the man who, in fact, helped me out last night, because there was some confusion over what time exactly the broadcast would have to start today. There were some rumors around that it would start at 8 CET as opposed to the 11 CET, which is now starting up. So yeah, it was good to see him confirm it all for me. So we do have our two best of threes. This could carry us through well, decently into the afternoon before we broadcast a little bit later on tonight, because I'll be streaming out the Dota 2 Champions Championship League later tonight. So if you guys are interested in that one, match coming up for you later this evening. But for now, let's look at our draft. Let's look at our battle between these two teams. So Darkseer as well as Batrun being banned out here by MVP. And we also removed the Alchemist as well as the Lich. Now, most of you would instantly look at that and just go, why the hell are we banning out an Alchemist? Not many people will play it. And you're actually right. There's not much point to really ban out this Alchemist bar. Almost filtering something else through. The Darkseer is in a very similar pool. He works nicely in Korean Dota, because in Korean Dota you normally look for the big 4 or 5 man group ups. I know I was talking about this yesterday when we're doing the Nexon Invitational live stream, but it's just the way that the Korea play right now. But they're starting to break out of the habit. They're now breaking into this world where you do stay on your lanes and you do look for the even trades. These guys have developed, and I can't believe how much, like I was watching a lot of their stuff from the Starter League, and then basically every single roster from this, from Korea has changed. There's not, probably not even a single team where you could say this is exactly the same roster as we had during the Starter League. And they've just developed so far in their game style. The initial picks were, I don't want to mock them, but They were kind of laughable, the original picks, and I'm not trying to mock them. I'm trying to show just how far these guys have come in such a short period of time. They're able to decode the game up nicely. MVP's got possibly the picks I like the most, where we get both the Pugna as well as the Visage. It's a very potent combination with our Soul Assumption, which is the 500 nuke damage at level 7, and then you got the Pugna with Decrepify. So you got 50% bonus on the back of that. So you catch out a hero like a Weaver, you still require a stun in order to do that, but this is a great option already for MVP with just two heroes. And more importantly, MVP, because they picked up the Pugna so early on, they've got to push down towers. Febby. He messaged me before in the lobby and was just like, yo, man, like, say my name, Febby. Febby is meant to be his name. So yeah, I'll try and do it, Febby. And then Bounty Hunter and Weaver will be his selections. And I like the fact he banned out the Enchantress and the Chen. You see the Pugna come up, you instantly say, okay, we've got to remove their big tank ability that lets them push down lanes. And Enchantress and Chen gives you that kind of momentum. Because you can take out tier 1, tier 2s, and if you win a fight on top of that tier 2 tower, then you can just keep going into the tier 3. Doesn't matter what time it is, because when you're with Pugna, if you get to have a level 4 blast, you can just destroy. That's the beauty of the Pugna. That's the absolute beauty of the Pugna. You can just blast down the towers and just keep pushing and pushing and pushing. And then you got all this bonus gold coming your way, goes to all the items for your team. Be it if you want to do the much favored of recent Necro books. Venom. Whoever has more Necro seems to win the game these days. At least in Southeast Asia and in China. In Europe, it's a little bit of a blend of something different. But we get Venomancer from FXO. So they add a Wall of Wards. Again, actually, not a bad hero to have up against Pugna. The wards, the Venomancer Plague Wards aren't affected by the Pugna Blast, but at the same time, it looks like MVP. Now we at least get one stun. It's a good range stun with the increase to the range of that Earthshaker stun. They got a long way to get in there. So, he has the nervous leg twitch like I do. The one where you get really, really, like, you want to move. You're either pumped up for this game, or you're just like, just let it start already. Just let it start already. And you get that little, like, 10 seconds remaining. That's what you get, peoples. Yeah, but the Venomancer, so strong. Talking about that with Loda last night, and he was even saying, yeah, it's kind of, he feels it's OP. And for me, it is. It really is. Even though they nerfed the Venomancer Gale very early on, you're not always looking for the tick damage out from that one. You're looking for something a little bit more. There's Kaiser on your screen. There's the man that made sure I got here on time. I would ask him to wave, but I'm not really there. Looking forward to meeting these boys, too. Gonna be over at the Nexon at the. I'm hoping I actually get over to the GOM TV Arena at some point when I'm over in Korea. In fact, I kind of want to check my schedule because I got a feeling I'm gonna miss one of the Nexon sponsorship matches. Nope, actually, they don't run any Nexon matches for the sponsorship league during that period. Keeper of the Not a single light. One. They're over. In fact, it's all over by the end of next week. Because that is what's happening. The Nexon Sponsorship League Grand Final is set for the 11th of the 9th. I think I might be waking up early to cast that. I might be casting it with Baskip because he's been doing every alternate day. So big shout out as well to Baskip. If you don't follow him already, please definitely go and do so. I think it's just Baskip on Twitter. But he's been doing the Saturdays because it's now 5 a.m. in the morning for me. Those Saturday matches, which these guys end up Five playing. So, yeah. Keeper of the Light coming out from FXO. So, I'm not 100% sure about this. I almost want to take this guy's facial expression and just go, that's Febby. That is Febby. but his expression is exactly what I kind of feel whenever I see Connell. But I don't know if we'll get the Lancer with this, and we kind of shouldn't. We've already got Bounty and Weaver. We're looking for a mid-solo as the last one out from FXO. And FXO think they're running a Klinks in this scenario. It was one of the heroes I remember I was having a chat to Harney about this to see if Klinks would even be legit. Because with the invis heroes for the offlanes now, with a shared experience, if you have yourself a jungler, Klinks is actually almost a perfect hero to play. You can get yourself a lot of quick damage, you get yourself a lot of quick levels, and all of this kind of, you've just got so much to play around with the Klinks. And it'll also be a good pickup if you get the Orc very early on up against the Weaver before he's capable of either picking up a BKB or picking up something different. And I say something different being Orchid. Lincoln Sphere. So it's just taking a little bit more time for the Weaver. And that's when Klinks can just walk all over him. But you need to have that high level of farm in order to get that. So that's beyond just leeching experience out of the jungle and stealing a creep here and there. Templar Assassin can be the last banner here by MVP. So makes me feel the puck for the last one. But you've already got a Pugna. He's already quite adept at doing middle lane. And then Nightstalker is the last one out from Febby. So Nightstalker in the middle lane, wondering if we're getting ET versus Night Stalker, if MVP feels that's the way to go. Because that means we just need one safe laner. One hero that can just sit up on MVP's top lane. Farm up. He can work with the Visage. Luna's still available in the pool as well. One of those heroes, though, you got to be rather cautious about because obviously you got the Night Stalker on the field and you don't want to give him indirect buff ups. So, 10 seconds remaining. Indirect, of course, being Eclipse turns the time to night. So, Night Stalker gets buffed up during the middle of the ultimate of Luna. Small things. Reserve time. But Hunji, last pickup now. And he'll be looking into... give us a drum roll, peoples. Give us a drum roll. 47 seconds on the clock. FXO. Like, I kind of like their lineup. I like their lineup in a way that, with a Venom and the Coddle, you can spam and be very over-aggressive on that top lane. You can leave the Bouncy on the bottom lane. You can put the Night Stalker in the mid. And send Weaver, Venomancer, and Coddle up to the top lane. You could take the Night Stalker up to the top lane as well. But I'm just liking the Shikuchi harassment you can get out from a Weaver with the follow-up slows, which you get from Venomancer and Coddle. You can do a lot of quick damage. Jara's going to be the last one here from MVP. A hero which really isn't played that much anymore. I kind of want to say just because of Flat Cannon. If I was going to pin it on one thing, I would just pin it on the Flat Cannon and say Flat Cannon just became insanely useless. that's the way I'm looking at it. It no longer targets things like familiars, and then with the longer cooldown as well, there's just other heroes that seem to be able to do it a lot better. But when you're going one-on-one and you got melee heroes that want to come in close, then he's actually quite good for it. Because then you got your battery assault, then you get your burst damage when someone wants to try and dive in under you. And the Bounty Hunter will normally do that. He'll try and isolate you as much as possible. But yeah, let's get ourselves into it. So we'll get ourselves into match number one of this best of three, with FXO going up against MVP. I also want to double check and make sure this is, in fact, a best of three. I'm not quite sure if they set the thing in game. Yeah, it is a best of three. They set the thing in game. So let's get ourselves into the game, peoples. Jump ourselves over. And get this party started. So, up towards the top lane, we've got Banhua taking up the role as the gyro. And do we get actually an aggressive tri-lane on the bot? On the bottom, we've definitely got Ferev moving down here already. Tangos, two clarities. He is really looking to spam out here and also be on the front lines. Walking around with that stout shield. Wants to make sure he's going to be contesting out for the CS. Ooh. I wonder what Koreans are. Korean HUDs. Oh, wow, really? Ah, oh, the monies! The monies! Can you feel the monies? Can you feel the monies? Yeah, man, this HUD is fully sick. I like these kind of things. These things are important to me, people. These things are important to me. I'm going to quickly refresh our camera up too. So hopefully it just smooths everything up for people watching. As I've also got to go bump and bump. Clean it up. The Midas HUD. Oh, I like that one. Midas HUD. All right. Let's look at our lanes. So, Mafia, this is a killing lane. When you put a ward down like this, oh, even look at his ward! He's got the Banjo-Kazooie ward! Those eyes! Regeneration. Fully pimped! Fully pimped in Korea! Pimps be alive. Kaiser's gonna go up towards the top lane as this Earthshaker. We had Banhua right behind him as well, so we're gonna run dual lanes. The funny thing is, we're talking about an Earthshaker lane during the Invitational match yesterday, where you could have, like, Windrunner and Earthshaker being your combination for the off lanes. Because with the Fissure, you've basically got so much control, especially with the bonus range of it now. You have a huge level of lol. Like this. Even if you want to right now, like, Kaiser can move to the other side. He's already popping up the Clarity. Fissure will come off cooldown in a moment. But with this, he's able to block him off from doing a straight-up pull on this camp. He's kind of missed his own pull timing, and I'm a little bit concerned about that bottom lane too. Mafia has, in fact, gone a very aggressive start to this, and this isn't something which most people will be ready for. Like, Febby has been really whittled down. He has to pop off the south and give himself some space. This middle lane, I'm really not sure about. Again, the Fissure. MVP is schooling. absolutely schooling FXO right now. But on this bottom lane, because you got the Spirit Harassment. Now, this is always going to burn through the life points of the Weaver. Luna's going to niggle on Kaiser. It stops his Cloudy, but he's still got the Fidget, so everything's fine there. But on this bottom lane, you had Mafia that went Soul Assumption level 1. And that's not something you normally do, because you're never really going to get high levels up in the charges. Normally, you're going to wait anyway until you hit your level 3 before you start using your Soul Assumption, unless there really is like a lot of damage being dealt out and you're searching for that big, big opening. That's kind of what you search for.
See this? I don't like this. I really don't like this.
I'm having issues with this middle lane. That's why I don't want to look at it anymore. But yeah, this bottom lane, you want to wait until you get your higher levels up in your damage threshold for the Visage Nuke, and then you dish it out. It only works if you're running like a tanky, aggressive tri-lane for the level 1, but most of the time you can just use your Grave Chill. Obviously, Grave Chill, though, has no real effect over on the Weaver. Oh, this should be a first blood. The Gale flies out. It's just trying to send on Gyro. He'll go into another Rocket Barrage right now. He's going to get it off on the Keeper of the Line. He does pop out the Luna, and they're splitting the damage. Soul Assumption will come in from Mafia. So there's your aggressive tri-lane, and they've taken two. There's going to be the Fissure as well. Mafia, he doesn't have mana to pop off that Soul Assumption, but they got extra support. The rotation in from the Pugna, and they're searching for March. I'm hearing a Bounty Hunter as well. Yeah, he's in behind. Everyone's rotated out from the lanes. 3 minutes. Five-man DOTA starts now. Oh, much. Decrepify. Spirit doesn't have it. He's going to bash, and the blast is too far away. Doesn't deal any damage to that Night Stalker. And the Fissure! Oh no! It was meant to block much up, and it's actually blocked the rest of his teammates out from chasing. Everybody rotates apart from the Weaver, who gets space in the bottom lane to farm and also push into the tier 1 tower. But first blood going the way of FXO, they'll get their Gale. Illuminate, move to the left. Evasion! Do a barrel roll! But now we get kind of what I was hoping for at the start of this. Because I really didn't see the fact that like Elder Tart needed any help down here. When he's got a stout shield and he's already walking around with his two clarities and consumables, he's absolutely fine. But dealing on this top lane with a Coddle that keeps doing this. Is that a level 2 blast now? Yeah, it's a level 2 blast. It's a level 1 chakra. So he is going a lot more harassment focused. I kind of want to go and talk about the middle lane. It's not something I really wanted to talk about because I'm not a huge fan of it. Because I could just see Bounty Hunter getting completely zoned out. If he didn't get that kill on the top lane on the Earthshaker when they're retreating back out again, then I'd still be concerned that he would even be able to stand at any kind of lane. But they're going to look to find up on this defensive tri-lane, which has no vision of what's going on. This is the Dire vision right here. They are blinded in a corner. We're in our first nighttime cycle. Nightstalker is looking for blood, and Bounty is looking for levels and then track gold, which he can't get. He rotates up, and it's all a bit of a waste of time. Luminous keeps spamming out. And the last two are able to miss absolutely everything, in fact. Weaver's running bottle on the bottom lane now. Yeah, but this middle lane, like Bounty Hunter going up against the Pugna. Now, most of the time, as you saw before, you just decrepify and blast him down. Pugna takes a lot of damage, has to burn through a lot of consumables. At the same time now, Pugna has overcommitted himself. He's got no mana available. Doesn't even matter when you've got Nightstalker come in like this. Shuri Toss from Bounty Hunter will get the kill. And now it's FXO that walk over MVP. MVP really had that, like, their lanes were so much stronger. And then this fight on the top lane, when they ended up getting caught out, Kaiser again going to throw that Fissure out. Need to be a little bit deeper to get that block in on the Venomancer. And Venomancer blocks him in. The ward to throw down. We got 1-1-1 across the board for him. Needs to find that second level up in Gale. It's just the damage over time you're searching for. He's really fishing with this as well. Doesn't really have the mana to spam on that. Your Plague Wards cost 20 a pop anyway. But that Venomancer Gale at 125. Venomancer is all about that mana conservation. March as well as Febby. On that bottom lane. Fareb just wants to hold him out. Look at Nightstalker going again. He's only got a little bit left. He's got a minute and a half left of night time right now. Searching for an opening. We'll have to move all the way up towards the top lane. But currently, Jaro is starting to get a little bit more farm. Boots are there, munched on his last tango, walking around with stick charges. But his farm is 20 for 2, which is actually around the same as the Night Stalker. So it's not as bad as it really could have been. This Bounty in the middle lane, he's the man who's going to be pulling in a lot more money later on. Illuminate flies, actually able to connect. The Gale as well on the Gyro, but then Fissure. Can see him move off the side. TP support came in rather quickly there from MVP. Not really required though. But having that Fissure wall block really just makes sure that FXO cannot dive in. There's no one like a Blink daggering RPing, skewering over the top of a Fissure Magnus.
Dire's bottom tower.
They're going to come up to the top lane. Four men Dota time. See, this is what I'm talking about with a couple of these teams from Korea, where they've managed to get themselves away from just getting really bunched up. Okay, March, crazy, crazy man. Void, he's already done it. Gale as well. The track is out, and they get the kill already. So track bonus gold, soul assumption damage is not going to leave March, happy with his life points, but at the same time, they got themselves a kill. Phase boost now come up for the Bounty Hunter as well, as he's got even more damage up his sleeve. And they can see the ET with the Earthshaker and the Visage up here on the top lane. Nightstalker's had to he is running back to base. His night time's going to wear off now. Hit the 8-minute mark and night time's gone. So the day doth dawn. Banhua going to go down towards the bottom lane. So he's now up against a Weaver. Not a favorable matchup after Weaver's had so much space and also so much farm. 46 for 2 on him, and they... Oh, the wings! Oh, look at it. That's not a nice death. That is not a nice death animation at all. More importantly, what did that courier have on it? Absolutely nothing. Oh, it's the cat. It was the cat courier. A tear is shed. But there's more cat couriers where that one came from. Look at him. He moves like a fish. You see him when he's on speed? And he just moves like a fish. His little wings just like pop off and the cat like hits the deck. Yeah. Alright, moving up towards the top. This time now MVP at least have vision of what's going on. You can call it a defensive observer ward, but you can see these Illuminates coming. Mafia. Okay, either he is knowing the exact range of the Illuminate, or he's not paying attention to that ward and what it's giving him. And even MVP now, we got Observers and Sentries here in the mid. This is just... kind of actually thought that would have come down during the first nighttime cycle. These guys have only been here for, just over a minute. But it does let MVP see quite clearly up to the high ground. Make sure there's no wards as well from FXO looking out for that kind of stuff. Sentry ward's actually a little bit too far back, so they can't deward the ones on the safe side. Oh, look at that life drain. Combining up with the Spirit, with a Fissure. So easy to initiate with that Fissure as well. As we talked about with Pugna, and something which MVP had to do with this kind of lineup, they needed to be pushing down towers very early on. And they've just managed to take at least the first tier 1 tower, but they're going to lose their top one. Venomance is pushing this out. Level 3 Plague Wards down. They're going to fortify to try and protect this. At the same time, Banhua diving or being dived, time-lapse. Ah, it's on cooldown. So Febby is going to take the damage. Tower's still going to go down by the Venomancer on the top lane. With the Plague Ward's there and no one else from MVP, it was always going to be death. Mafia hanging out inside the pit, and Kaiser's also on this bottom lane. Looks like he's building into Arcane Boost, but he's going to go for the Energy Booster first. That's really going to help out for Rev when he starts spamming out his abilities too. I'm going to track over on Pugna, Mr. DD. And he just D-wards out, and then the D-ward of the D-ward. Unfortunately, when you throw down a Sentry Ward, the new Dire Creep Wave's coming in, you're going to lose that ward straight away. And Bounty at it too slow. Now, one range creep, doing it for the team, for MVP, without putting Hoonji in a position where he was at risk. But at the same time, he is. Venomance is going to be coming in, going to be looking for that Gale. But with a Void to set up, they could possibly do it, but the Void's being used to farm instead. And Pugna will just blast down most of the creep wave. bottom lane. Oh, that's actually a lot of damage by the Spirit being done. Fissure as well. Weaver not using his time lapse. There goes your cooldown. It's going to slow down the bounty as well as keep her the light. But with the track movement speed, slowdown isn't really the problem here. And there's no extra Fissure. Shuritos able to get the kill on the Jairus to get another track kill. And then moving into Ferev. Puts out a quick Spirit, but now he'll go down as well. Now the ward's on the deck. And the Observer Wall will spot it around the corner. So Cotter will get rid of this one as quickly as possible. Takes three attacks from a hero now to get rid of that Nether Ward. We get a Phase Boots Gyro. Everything's just a little bit slower. It's a very defensive Illuminate. Not even putting it up the lane. Like, he's just expecting a gank to come in from, like, this direction. Fissure now flies the bottom lane. Febby still very, very low on life, walking around and getting hit by these fissures when he's on agility treads. But there's urn charges in the kitty of March. He's also using the remainder of his bottle charges. And then Chakra. Not Chakra, I'm casting too much Timbersaw. Sargun gonna be pushing at the middle. Look at his farm. Are we getting a straight Aghanim Scepter Venomancer? I'm kind of hoping it's a casual point. He doesn't like the air. He doesn't like the air. See that? He's got a Coddle that's coming to him. No, he doesn't. He's just going back to base. It just felt like throwing the gale in case he got lucky. I like his confidence at least. Oh, Rando. You can see the courier. That actually would have been a really big snipe if he took it. He's going to get it on the way back though. Boom! Boom, 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 boom. Face boost. I'll die for it. Oh, he's in trouble. TP. There's no stun. And the damage is not enough to kill him off. Ranto, Korean version of Bone 7. Every cat's a goal, people. Every cat's a goal. Bottom tier 1 tower's really being pressured out. With the Spirit down here, though, it will get rid of a lot of this pressure. And the tower is just above deny range. And then the Illuminate. Well, there's your own pressure. Allows you to push in. Fissure or not, Anarchy just moves himself back. This is possibly the easiest build you can have coming out from a Coddle. Obviously, the Ancestral Spirit is an absolute dick when it comes to harassment, range damage onto a Keeper of the Light. But at the same time, Coddle, when you run Tranquil Boots, oh, they're going to fight this one. Look for the Blinding Light, try and push him back. Yeah, it does. Mafia already tracked up, and that's a lot of bonus gold coming out from that. Keeper of the Light did go down at the end of the day. It looks like the Familiar Birds actually came in from behind. If Venomancer cleans up this creep wave fast enough, they might be able to pick up a couple of these guys on the way out. Because Visage was the man who died. Nope, they don't have damage for it. And Nightstalker was too busy farming up the creep wave. As opposed to focusing on those birds, which give a lot more money. Not to mention the experience. Yeah, but normally I'd say, like, Keeper of the Light will be fine. Because Coddle, it's just one of these guys that, like, you Tranquil Boots, you've always got mana for it. Ranto. Oh, you might have enough for this. Track, Shuri toss, your dust's gonna go out. Just throw the Shuri. You're gonna die anyway. Okay. Donating spree being ended by the Visage. Giving him more monies.
Dire's structures are fortified.
Well, middle lane. Febby's trying to push this one out. There's gonna be a little bit more support coming in for Rev with the Spirit going down. At least Febby's taking a lot of damage from this one without a time lapse, so chasing is a little bit harder. But Marsh doesn't want to give up on this. Urn charge is not going to be enough. Not with the Weaver Bugs as well falling off. But that was his last ditch effort here. We are at 2 a.m. on the clock. So it's not going to be long before we go into our next daytime phase. Nighttime, of course, being extended by the darkness, so it must be 16:25. I don't think he's used it twice yet, or else we're looking at 1650. Simple math. Extend the night time by 25 seconds two times, and then you, like, normal crossover time of 16 minutes. We are looking at a straight-up Aghanim Scepter. Unless he goes into 4-staff. But it looks like we're actually looking at a straight Aghanim Scepter for a Venno.
Very unusual. With that Illuminate spam too, Bounty Hunter. You know he wants to do it, but he's also remembering. He's remembering what happened last time. Still hunting for couriers, hunting for heroes that are low. The Illuminate spam obviously gives him heroes at low, like Kaiser. And this guy has only got straight arcane boots, so he does become a bit of a one-hit wonder, but at the same time, he's still a strength support hero. So he's got just under 1,000 life points. Are they ganking up for the top lane, or are they? No, they're not going to get there in time. Walking and smoke movement now by MVP. So they'll try and come in and look for the Bounty Hunter. Someone got Dust, they got Sentry Wards, and Kaiser didn't drop it fast enough. The Dust will pop and keep it light. Oh, we try to pull in the Bounty Hunter. The Crippify Spirit. Oh, man! No, that's not even... That's an overdunk. That's an overdunk. He is snapping the backboard with that. Unnecessary ultimate. They kill nonetheless. And Venomancer just seems to be going now carry road. Yep, Ogre Club. He's going straight at him. Doesn't matter if he doesn't have the mana. The mana regeneration to push out the lane. He's got the Keeper of the Light. It's fine. He just needs the Keeper of the Light to stay with him most of the time. Which right now, Venomancer is his own man. Down this bottom lane. One fun thing to see is the fact we don't have a single minus on the field. I'm happy for that. That's Febby. Oh, we are going old school. We're going Radiance Weaver, peoples. We're going Radiance Weaver. I haven't seen this in a while. Especially not as, like, I suppose you could call it a third item because he's got his treads and Ring of Aquila. But this is real old school Weaver kind of build. Normally not done anymore because the Weavers are all about stability. Obviously, if you do have your Radiance Burn, you could do a lot of harassment damage, but you really rely on being able to move around during the fight. So your other heroes are going to make that space for you. March. ET, ulti, that was never going to connect. Haste Runes all was in the bottle for Nightstalker. Fissure will go, but it ends up holding Hunji out. He can't fit through that small little gap there. So they're forced back out again. Still waiting in the corner. Ranto's up here. Dire Sentry Ward is there, but there's no other vision coming in for MVP. But Febby. Oh, he sees so many of them. Decrepify. He's still got time lapse. The Dust's going to pop. Time lapse. Time lapse. Time lapse. It's kind of worth it, man. It's really kind of worth it. The Keeper of the Light's dragging him back. And he's going to pull him into the middle lane of all places and then give him a mech charge. Give him some mana. Alright, so he doesn't want to use the time lapse at any possibility. And they're going to push in towards the middle lane now. I'm still liking MVP's lineup a little bit more. Through all of this, I'm still seeing their stuns, I'm still seeing their jumping potential. If this Blink Dagger comes at any point for Kaiser, then FXO could find themselves in a lot of trouble. At the same time though, FXO have a lineup which is able to move around the map and really just snowball momentum in. We get a 20 minute Radiance. It's a little bit slower than the Radiance you normally try and go when you go for a Weaver like this. But the reason for it is because he did go the treads whilst the Ring of Aquila. Oh, they can see him perfectly. They can see him perfectly. With the Dire Sentry Ward and the Spirit on the high ground. Fissures him from the side. Very simple kill for MVP. And there's that whole stability kind of thing that you search for with a Weaver, which you just don't have with this guy. So push the tier 1 tower in the bottom lane. Don't really have a lineup for pushing unless the Pugner is there. I'm talking about MVP, obviously. Radiance bottom tower is under attack. So the Pugner kind of needs to be there with him. And Hunji's going to make his way down there. But right now, Nightstalker, he wants to fight. Runs in through the rear. There goes again. Baiting out the ET Ultimate for Grave Chill. Trying to slow down this Nightstalker during the nighttime. For Rev, he's got another Spirit available. Throws it out. Going to hit on the Keeper of the Light as well as over to that Nightstalker. Blinding Light, trying to push Ferev up the hill, not just put on the missed chances for him. Because Ferev, he's got some decent damage up his sleeve. Soul Assumption, then one last into the other Titan. It's a good Illuminate as well, doing us some decent damage. If only he could stay alive throughout all of it too. And now, TP's out, Elder Titan will bail. The Radiance Burn effect from the Weaver. Now it's going to work when you're all locked inside such a small little corridor. And they're a little bit too concerned about that Night Stalker. MVP end up losing multiple heroes just to the burn. And is that also a straight... it's a BKB. I'm happy for that. Called out. Oh, he can actually take a triple kill here right now. Rocket Barrage, BKB, Rocket Barrage takes the Night Stalker, comes in towards Roshan, but the two Invis boys jump down. They got another Rocket Barrage available as well. Febby as well as Bounty under, they're tanking it up, and then the time-lapse out from Febby. Gives him his life points back. But man, you know that whole gamble you have as a Weaver? Where you get such a big damage shielding and presence item very early on. And then you're able to pick up a couple of kills. So now he's 3-1 with 132 CS. He'll have his items which give him stability. Kind of looking towards the heart for his next one. Illuminate flies and Shikuchi and Radiance does the rest. This time FXO is also prepared. They got Sentry Wars down here in the mid. They don't want MVP to have lane vision. Not straight up lane vision, at least.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
Smoke movement by MVP. Still, Luminance flying out. The Akinim Scepter Venomancer. First level. I'm still not quite sure about this, but we'll go with it. Right now, he's in a little bit of trouble. He doesn't have Venomancer ulti, he won't get a Gale off, and he just pops instantly in the mid. It's just a Venomancer with a lot of confidence, and the smoke gank only picks up the Venno, however. So at the end of the day, we still have to bear in mind that it's a support Venno. The support Venno was the guy that was able to build the Aghanims from the very, very start. The other heroes out there, which he caused, Bounty Hunter on his way to a BKB, Night Stalker has his, as well as a gem. You got a BKB, looks to be on the way from Weaver. Track inside the pit on top of Kaizen now means they've got perfect vision inside the pit. They know exactly when to fight. Unfortunately for Marge, the Crevet fight, Fissure won't connect. Life Drainer also on cooldown. And the Fissure is kind of blocked off the rest of FXO from getting in there, but the tracks will continue. Stomp trying to be done, actually does get two of them put to sleep. At the same time, the Gyro, he's on the run. Marge can't finish the job on him though. Will be caught in this very, very small choke point. Visage getting nailed down by the Bounty, and the tracks just continue. Pugna's low on life. Marge looking for the silence, and then follow up Void, and then Ranto. Just Janata hits him down. He's still got Shuri Toss, and there it flies. Triple kill comes out for Ranto. Febby came back into the fight as well, just saying hello. He picks up one during that. And now FXO will take out Roshan. MVP, they thought they were all home and hose to go in for that, but when that first track came down, they had to basically bail out of the pit just then. With the vision, even with like an Earthshaker with the Fissure, like they try to come out and fight. The fight didn't work. They had some abilities on cooldown and FXO just pounced on that moment. Now Venomancer can finally buy his Arcane Boots. That's all I'm currently waiting for. With the Venomancer with Arcanes, you're basically good for life. And you don't have to rely on Febby. He's waiting a long time on that one. Doesn't want to bring that tower within denier range, and rightly so. Catapult shouldn't do that. 175, yeah, Catapult dies pretty quickly. But this Venomancer is not giving up on the wards. Gotta be careful the fact how much experience these things now do give off. It's a little bit more than it used to be. Middle lane just gonna be pressured up by the Keeper of the Light. Full channel loot, it normally kills off most of the creep waves, and then you got Radiance and Febby again. Oh, Febby, he doesn't have time lapse this time. Stomp's gonna go. It's in range of the tower. The Aegis will trigger. He'll purchase his BKB just in cases. And now, wow, the commitment to the tower. The Pugna blast to get rid of most of the creep wave. And now we also hit daytime. March's gotta deal with this. Those stomps going out, and now BKB. He's chasing down the kill on Kaiser. The Creeper fight trying to save him from the attack, but at the same time, with the BKB triggered off, he time-lapses out of the base. Picks off the Earthshaker. Back to what Febby started as he lost the AC model, which was this tier 2 tower. The fortification's going to be slowing him down as well. But they're looking with the call down. Keeper of the light a little bit too close. Has to pop the mag charge. It's still enough to keep him alive. Pugna will get the kill on that one. And Febby, he is still trying to get rid of this damn tower. It's one more attack away. Is he coming to just try and snipe it off here at least? I almost want to watch that beyond everything. Look at Febby. Yeah, you knew it. You knew it was coming. He's still got his Radiance Burn on the field. And with the track over on Gyro, they know how far they can commit themselves, but the 3 euros from MVP are going to be falling themselves back to base, and the Earthshaker's already coming out from there. But FXOff taking all out of towers apart from that tier 2 tower on the bottom lane now. And they've only lost their tier 1 tower in the mid. So if we... I kind of... In Korean games, I didn't even want to bring this up. But I know people at home always want to see it. So, yeah. There is no surprise that FXO was so far ahead on the monies. 17,000 gold going their way. 12,000 for the experience. Oh, that's a nice rune to pick up on the way out. Being dragged to the bottom lane with a regeneration rune. And he's still got time lapse. Oh, life drain, mech charge. There's also a rocket on top of Febby. Pop that regeneration rune and wants to stay away. Ah, he's going to kill off the rocket anyway. Bounty's on the hunt again. Are they going to group up for a smoke? Oh, sentry's down. I don't know if they're waiting for the bounty hunter, if they're waiting to actually group up and smoke. But the bounty's coming in from behind the lines. They may have caught a quick glimpse of that, hence the pinks. But Forever is holding back. Four-star build for him. Still got those two BKBs fully up. So even if they do find Ranto, if they don't get that initial stun, should be able to get himself away. Febby. Radiance Burn kills off the creep wave. They're committing 5 players from MVP to try and stop this. The big problem they have is this top lane just kept farming and pushing. We're going for an Aghanim set to build up on the Night Stalker. So we're going to look for legal map pack coming out from this NS. Look at the money to really afford that too. And Febby's had enough of this. Comes into the site, throws the bugs out, wants Mafia. With the BKB as well, Shikuchi just to keep himself in range for it all. Tracks over on Kaiser. Time-lapse already been used too, and that Illumina hits hard. And that means dive time for Febby. He can pick off a rev. Nice hit by Kaiser. Throws out the Echo Slam. Was the only way to keep Febby away from that Elder Titan. And with the BKB off from the Bounty Hunter, just moves away from, well, I would say a potential Rocket Barrage, but there wasn't really a lot of mana to go with it. And they'd start their own dewarding. March in a little bit of trouble. Caught in the creep. Yeah. There you go. Has to pop the ultimate. Needs the movement speed to get himself away from both the Rocket as well as the creep wave with Familiars. Actually, no, the Rocket goes to Keeper of the Light of all people. Is under attack. Febby at least lucky enough to find himself another rune, so he doesn't have to back himself off. But he will be wanting to push out that bottom lane. Tier 2 tower is still the primary goal here for FXO. All out of towers. Got to push out the top lane as much as he possibly can too, and just bait them away. A flying gale from the Venomancer. But this is what we were searching for on the bottom lane before from FXO. The team fight, it just had to happen because MVP wanted to defend their tier 2 tower. They made that choice. So FXO had to make the bounty hunter doing some early scout work and trying to find them the advantage before they push down the towers. And now you get the Aghanim Scepter. Unfortunately for him, we are still in daytime, so he doesn't have that legal map pack up properly. Luckily for him, he's also got 2 levels up in that nighttime, so he's already able to extend it for a decent period of time. And Hang on, wait, what? Yeah, I was like, he bought a blink dagger, but why? And then sold the blink dagger. Oh. All right, so Ranto's farming up bottom lane now. He built into a Vladimir's offering. He's used every single drum charge he's got. And Venomancer, screw Arcane Boots. This is like Next level farming Venomancer. Because he's going Necrobooks now. Now he's going Necrobooks. Ultimate all but for Febby as well, so maybe a bit of a late Lincoln Sphere for him. Keeper of the Light always wants friends, so he'll drag March out to the front lines. And after Weaver's gone back to base to heal up, without having to use that haste rune of his, then Collar can pull him in. Venomancer. Alright. Aldi's had us a... that's actually a real sticky effect up on that top lane. They use a mech to actually repel the damage of that. Now you see actually a power of a Venomancer. That's just his ultimate. You add that level of damage during a team fight. So when I was casting with Valk the other night, we were talking about a Venomancer. Primary goal, get the ultimate off during a team fight. That's it. That's seriously it. You don't need to do much more than that. Pugna. Void. Silence. No follow-up though. Marge kind of knows he can do this because he's always able to get his mana back from the Keeper of the Light. So he can be very aggressive with just his abilities from range.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
As he goes around deep warding everything. That legal man pack into the base. That's it. That's his. Well, hang on. No, that's a bitch because we have an observer one. I'm thinking that's way too deep for him. But you can see unobstructed vision. Doesn't care about tree lines. Doesn't care about anything like this. Weaver again going to be searching for a rune. Regeneration up on the top. So checks bottom. We'll get unlucky. Looks like he's going to start farming up instead of taking out the rune. But once they see the regeneration, they'll give it over to Febby. His base regeneration is not really high enough, even though he has that Lincoln Sphere now. I think most of the time, he'll be looking to put that Lincoln Sphere charge over on the Night Stalker, and not himself. Because the NS is diving in pretty deep. An MVP. Well, having a Night Stalker running around after your initial stun, like what is even your initial stun or trigger? You want to do Grave Chill? Meh. Keeper of the Light. Whoa, Connell. That's almost worth a four staff away. But not going to happen here. And Cuddle wants more help. The Illuminates will fly. And actually able to connect on two of the heroes as well. Small little problems. Level 2 Necrobooks now up for the Venomancer. Cuddle just keeps that pressure going. While Weaver does the same. Everything's just so split. Venomancer holds the top. You got 3 heroes who are ready to fight in the middle lane and can rotate to any lane pretty quickly because obviously Night Stalker, very fast movement. And then you've got a Weaver pushing the bottom. And with a sporadic wall placement from Venomancer 2, he can back himself up and still have a lot of support units. And once he pops off the Necro books, then the Necro units, then you got even more units out there that can help you escape. And this Collar will just not let up. Illuminate after Illuminate, while the rest of FXO take Roshan. So Febby, oh, he's so close to picking up the Reaver. He's so close to picking up the Reaver. Sells the bottle. And I'm just feeling the Reaver right now after he farms up this ancient area. Trying to do a stack, but just a little bit too late in the pull. Stomps again up on this top lane. 4 staffs up. A little bit fearful of that fissure of Earthshakers. So we've got the Reaver now up and Weaver. Yeah, we do. So, old school. Radiance and then a whole lot of defense. Coming from his BKB, his Lincoln Sphere, as well as having that Reaver now up on him. So very hard to kill off Weaver. Just can run up against Mafia. Medallion of Courage being used. Try and bring down the Weaver. At the same time, like now Lincoln Sphere will trigger when the Soul Assumption comes down. The Weaver's going to back up. Decrepify is there, he's been hit by the Spirit. Once he gets the heart up, he'll be fine with this kind of harass because he just regenerated so quickly. As the Stomps do go out, but that Illuminate, no one's going to hit by it. Oh no, they walk into it. Kaiser on the edge of it, and Weaver's in. Throws out the bugs, pops the BKB. He's still got time lapse and will use it. Bails out as the tracks still keep coming. And there's another covering fire Illuminate. Going through that Visage, Soul Assumption damage is very, very minimal to that Bounty Hunter. And we're going for another Illumit. They're just assaulting now. They've left the top lane. Venomance has shifted himself towards the middle. And this is just the attempt to breach the base. Oh, Familius had to drop. Successful, though. Weaver's damage is almost enough with just that one attack and then into the Gemnet attack. He's able to pick off one of those Familiars. Use the Invis to evade a little bit more. Ah, Familiar down to very low life. ET ulti. It's too far away from the Venomancer. And he's still got the ultimate before death. Most important thing for him right now. Bounty Hunter's on the way in. Now he, however, is way too far in on that tower. And with the Nether Ward down, more abilities you want to be casting, the worse it is for you. Febby, Vanhua, I think he's really underestimating the power of that Weaver. You still have the Aegis Immortal up on him, but it's the DPS which I'm talking about, especially in comparison to that Gyro. And the Gyro's got 3,400 gold right now. Interested to see what he builds into with Koreans, you never know. I know a lot of people in the chat would always be like, well, I'm always in search of my Rapier. But with this lineup, slaving a Monkey King bar is a very good idea. Rapier's always a great idea. But actually, not really at this. You saw how much damage he took from the Weaver. If you go out for the raw damage, Weaver will just dive focus you and take your Rapier from you. Keeper of the Light brings the Venomancer back. Full size device now finished up for the Pugner. So at least he managed to find himself something after picking up that mech, but we're now almost, well, we're 38 minutes into this game. Four star far from Mana Leak already. Pops the BKB, and it's going to TP himself out of this one. He's got enough life points, he'd be okay. Spirit still going down as well, and Febby just wants these lanes pushed out as far as possible. These Necro units, they're on a mission from God. They're coming in for the tower. The backdoor regeneration, however, will still kick in. Careful who kills that off. Actually, ends up being Mafia. Got the last hit, because he uses Familiar still, he doesn't take the damage. That was also changed around recently, that you, same thing with Spike Carapace. Like, Spike Carapace won't trigger if you use an illusion to hit it. Like, it won't trigger on your hero directly anymore. It should affect the unit. There's your heart now up for Febby. So now, it's just going to be over-level harassment. Bounty Hunter's back up to the top lane, so he wants to push this lane out as quickly as possible. Febby, fortification has to be used for this. He time-lapses out. There's your jump in for the Echo Slam. Catching out both the Venomancer as well as the Keeper of the Light. Febby pops the BKB. Has to run himself away. At the same time, that top lane is still being pushed out. For some reason, Cuddle is going to be picking up his Blink Dagger. Lol. Moonji, Febby, back into the Invis. He's got him. Oh no, the Gemnet attack with the burn! Gemnet attack was stopped. Because he put the Tegrimify up on himself, but then the Radiance Burn did its thing. Mafia looking for a kill here. The Sentry Ward definitely shows him. They can see him. And Febby, if he takes the high ground here, yeah, walk away from the Spirit. He just wants space to heal. His heart will kick in, and then 69 life points a second. Almost 70. 69.8. Basically 70. 4k gold on the Nightstalker as well, so he'll be looking to his Assault Cuirass. And those Ranks will take a fall. Febby. Oh, he's even going to pick up both the Familiars. Yeah, he does. Both Familiars go his way. I don't think Visage has resummoned. No, he doesn't. They were fresh Familiars as well. That's actually a really huge blow. They've just lost two big stunts and a lot of damage. As Febby just popped up to the high ground and ended up taking it out. And now, well, Flat Cannon. It's going to push the creep wave back out again. They still can't pick up the Weaver. Because he just does this. He runs in, does harassment damage, and then backs off. ET threw the ulti out. No, he didn't. What the hell was that? Oh, it's the fissure effect. Tired eyes, people. Tired eyes. My apologies. Now the gem is up on the Pugna. They really just want to make sure they see Febby coming in. And now Febby, well, he does, but he doesn't care if they see him or not. What are you going to do? Like, he's bringing down the range racks, and I love the fact he's focusing it down. I'll talk about that in a moment, because Febby, snap back in again. Aegis, a good trigger. Couldn't get the time lapse off in time. But the tier 3 tower in the mid's being attacked, and Febby, well, actually, wait, what? Wait, what? The Aegis reclaimed before it? Oh, lol. Lol.
I think it's ready for that. Venomoni will go. Gale actually managed to connect on three there. Blinding Light almost bouncing back. The Earthshaker winds up getting the kill with the Fissure. But that Venomancer ulti is really ticking down Hoonji. He's down at 41. Care of the wards. Venomancer goes critical. Shuri Toss will cancel the Visage TP out. They got another Illumina for cover fire. The gem picked up here by the Gyro. The BKB is being used. Blinding Light pushing him down. Good stomp. Good Fissure. Keeps the Nightstalker away from them. Oh, Fevy's going to be spitting chips about that Aegis. Monkey King by now on for the Gyro. Oh, man. Yeah, but this bottom lane, bottom barracks are under attack. Attacking the range racks, because it doesn't regenerate anymore. So if you're looking for the bonus advantage in the lane, and you don't think you can bring it down straight away, and you're going to do it bit by bit time over time, then the range racks are the better racks to go for. Obviously, the melee racks are the one you want to have in the lane, but if you're still slowly doing it, yeah. Necro units coming up at the tier 3 tower. Catapult's already attacking it as well for Rev. Tanks up any kind of damage to the Necro units. And then on your bottom lane, Febby's back. Mr. Crystallis now, so building into a Daedalus for himself. Dealing out a lot of damage. And there's your Nightstalker's AC. Took a little bit of extra time than I thought it was going to, but it is here. Their advantage stretching up to 30,000 gold. Going the way of FXO. Experience coming back down a little bit more, but that's because now it's all like even contesting in the lanes. It's gonna change around once you get another creep up, and really we're getting a level 3 Necro book up on the Bounty Hunter. So we've got two level 3 Necro books up for FXO. And they're gonna defend on top of their tier 3 towers, and now, well, Manalik, Fissure, but then Gyro, he summed himself up. He drained every inch of mana he had. And stuns himself up while Febby, he's back at the job again. Millie racks in the bottom now gone. While Marge pushes in the top and he wants to take out this tier 3 tower. Realize just how far away MVP is. He gets a couple of hits, but actually, it's, look at the, it's just out of denial range. It has to be below 10%. And it's not below 10%, which means that tower cannot be denied. BKB from Febby, he commits to the melee racks using his BKB to do so. Tier 3 tower is dropped on the top lane. Kaiser with that blink dagger. ET ulti coming in as well. And it's going to snap back and brings down the bounty hunter. Venomance, however, will get his ulti off. And this will slow everybody down. And you just look to see, yeah, Marge going to come back in again. Venomance is in fact hitting all these kills. While Febby is deep on the tier 4 towers. If he gets close enough, one more attack and he's got Mafia. Even with the well regeneration, GG call will come out, and rightly so. This game belongs to FXO. I kind of had a lot higher hopes for this MVP lineup at the very, very start, but at the end of the day, just too strong. Just too strong coming out from FXO. They take game number one. Oh, look at that. It looks, almost looks too easy for them on the cameras there. But MVP, definitely something to think about with the way they approach this game. We're going to go to a very, very short break, peoples. But we'll be coming back here for your Nexon Sponsorship League in just a couple of moments' time. Game number two of the best of three. We're at the winner's bracket semi-final. FXO versus MVP.